So we had continued with the reading of the chapter, The Enemy, and Dr. Sadao is now in a big dilemma. What is that situation that he's faced with? He's come across a white person and he is thinking that should he leave that person on the shore or should he carry him home, right? And now, of course, if he leaves him to die, right? So as a doctor, that is not what he is supposed to do. If he takes him home, he will be in trouble, right? Because it is a time of war. And if anybody goes and reports about him, what is going to happen? They will be calling him a traitor, that he is going against the country. How can you give shelter to a white person? Okay. So now let's see here. What does he do actually? Now, so Hannah and Sadao, they're suggesting to each other that we should throw him back in the sea. But was any one of them doing that? Were they ready to pick up the man and put him back in the sea? No, right? Because in you know, their heart of hearts, of course, they are all, they were good human beings, okay? And were they afraid of the American? Yes, were they afraid? How can you be afraid of a wounded person? A person who's half dead, who's lost so much of blood, is so weak. How can you be afraid of that person? Must be acting, yeah. He's put a fake blood is coming out. Ketchup, yeah, right? He said he must be acting. No, you've seen too many movies, right? Too much of Bollywood. Okay, so here, what is there about Hannah and Dr. Sadao that makes them different from other Japanese people? It is both of them have been to America. Where did they have their studies? Where did they go for their education? They went to America. So they have interacted with the Americans. They know them, you know, like, and so they are not as such, you know, like having that kind of a stereotypical or their prejudiced thinking. So now, yes, here, both of them, they have discussed that if they take them home, what is going to happen? They're going to put their lives as well as their children's lives in danger. The servants' lives also, someone might go and report about them. And what will happen? So now will be sent to prison. Right? He will be considered as a traitor. Okay? Someone who is not, you know, like thinking about his country. So we start with the next page. We must simply tell them that we intend to give him to the police. This line? Yes, which page is it? Okay, so 23 or 29. We must simply tell them, here, page 29. That is also a very old book, which I have, okay? So page 29 on that book also. So yes, those of you are at home, you can look at the screen. We must simply tell them that we intend to give him to the police, as indeed we must. We must think of the children and your position. What about the position of Sadao? He has a very reputed position. He's a respectable person. He's a doctor. He's a scientist and he has the trust of the general, right? Who has not sent him with the troops so that he can be taken care of. It would endanger all of us if we did not give this man over as a prisoner of war. Harsimar, can you look at the book? Certainly, Sadao agreed. I would not think of doing anything else. So what are we going to tell them? That, see, we brought this man, but we do not intend to keep him over here. And when he's better, we're going to hand him over. Thus agreed together, they lifted the man. He was very light, like a fowl that had been half starved for a long time. What's a fowl? A bird, right? And until it is only feathers and a skeleton. So he was light as a bird. The young man was not a burden to carry. So his arms hanging, they carried him up the steps and into the side door of the house. This door opened into a passage and down the passage, they carried the man towards an empty room. It had been the bedroom of Sadao's father and since his death, it had not been used. So why do you think they made him enter through the side door? Yeah, nobody should see them and nobody should notice him coming from the front door. And yes, and they took him to the empty room that was their father's, which had not been used since his death. It had been the bedroom of Siddharth's father, and since his death, it had not been used. They laid the man on the deeply matted floor. Everything here had been Japanese to please the old man, who would never in his home sit on a chair or sleep in a foreign bed. So, of course, we do know about the, you know, Japanese traditions here. The Japanese tradition of tea is there, very famous, and they sit on the floor, right? So here, his the father was there, a very traditional old man, and he would follow all the Japanese customs. So he did not have a bed, he would not sit in the chair, right? So his room was still done in the old Japanese style. Hana went to the wall cupboards and slid back the door and took out a soft quilt. She hesitated. The quilt was covered with flowered silk and the lining was pure white silk. So she took it out, the pure white silk quilt. She was hesitant. Why? Might become dirty, right? So yes, the man was bleeding. He is so dirty, she murmured in distress. Yes, he had better be washed, Sadao agreed. If you will fetch hot water, I will wash him. So see, Sadao has not hesitated at all. Was there an incident before this that showed that Sadao was a very, you can say, concerned person as a doctor? What did he do when he saw the man bleeding? What did he do? Yeah, sand he put. Moss. So see, moss was there and he put that to stop the bleeding. Now immediately, what did he say? As soon as the man has been brought inside, what does he say? That he needs to be washed and then his wounds, they need to be taken care of. If you will fetch hot water, I will wash him. I cannot bear for you to touch him, she said. We shall have to tell the servants he's here. I will tell Yumi now. She can leave the children for a few minutes and she can wash him. So what is Hana there? Of course, even though they have lived in America, but right now the situation is such that she also thinks that Americans are their enemy. She does not want that her husband should touch the soldier. So she says, there's no need for you to touch him. The servants can wash him, right? But as a doctor, do you think it's possible? It's not possible. Yes, yeah, Sadao considered a moment. Let it be so, he agreed. You tell Yumi and I will tell the others. So you tell Yumi and I will tell the other servants that we have, this person at home. But the utter pallor of the man's unconscious face moved him first to stoop and feel his pulse. So as he was about to leave, right, Krish? What did he notice? The pallor of the man's unconscious face. What is pallor? Yes, because of weakness. What has happened to the color? Looking very pale, looking very dull. Right? And if you remember in My Mother at 66 also, we have come across this word. We have come across this word in elementary school classroom in a slum also. Isn't it? Yes. So, but the utter pallor of the man's unconscious face moved him first to stoop and feel his pulse. Harsimar, the spirit is not for sleeping. Oh, really? Mm-hmm. I will just wait. It was faint, but it was there. What was faint? The heartbeat. Yes, very good. He put his hand against the man's cold breast. The heart too was yet alive. He was alive, right? So he got afraid. The man was looking very pale and he was quite unconscious. So he checked for his pulse. The man was alive. He will die unless he is operated on. Who will operate on the man? Sadao will operate. Yes. Sadao said, considering. The question is whether he will not die anyway. What does this mean? The question is whether he will not die anyway. What? Haan, bilkul. So whether I operate or not, he is going to die. So it is better that I operate. Give him a chance to live. Yes. Hana cried out in fear. Don't try to save him. What if he should live? Then what is going to happen? He's an American, right? He's the enemy. So she's scared. Yeah, might kill us. Okay. Yes. What if he should die? Sadao replied. He stood gazing down on the motionless man. This man must have extraordinary vitality. or he would have been dead by now. But then he was very young, perhaps not yet 25. What does vitality mean? Vital, vitality. No, not immunity. It is vital is life. Yes, right? So he is there, full of that life, full of that liveliness. And why do you think it is like that? In spite of bleeding, and it seems he's had this wound, right? He's got a bullet in his back. It's been a couple of days. The man is still alive. He's a young man. It's a lot of energy. Yes, he's not yet 25. You mean die from the operation? Hannah asked. Yes, Sudhav said. Hannah considered this doubtfully, and when she did not answer, Sudhav turned away. At any rate, something must be done with him, he said. And first, he must be washed. He went quickly out of the room, and Hannah came behind him. She did not wish to be left alone with the white man. So Hannah is very scared. And when Sudhav left, what is Gitesh doing? Inko bhi bahar nikalo, we'll send him out. Yes, right here, send him out. Okay, yes, so Hannah was scared of being alone, right? So just imagine how much fear people have, right, regarding the enemy, that Hannah did not want to be alone with that unconscious person. She was harmless at that moment, but even then she felt scared. So she left the room immediately when Sadao went. She did not wish to be left alone with a white man. He was the first she had seen since she left America. And now he seemed to have nothing to do with those whom she had known there. So it's been a long time since she left America. And this man, of course, he's completely different and he is not like them. Here he was her enemy, a menace, living or dead. What does menace mean? It's a problem. So living or dead, he is an enemy. And he's more so when he's alive, okay? So right now he's unconscious and even then he's still the enemy. She turned to the nursery and called Yumi, but the children heard her voice and she had to go in for a moment and smile at them and play with the baby boy, now nearly 3 months old. Over the baby's soft black hair, she motioned with the mouth, Yumi, come with me. I will put the baby to bed, Yumi replied, he is ready. She went with Yumi into the bedroom next to the nursery and stood with the boy in her arms while Yumi spread the sleeping quilts on the floor and laid the baby between them. Then Hannah led the way quickly and softly to her kitchen. The two servants were frightened at what their master had just told them. What do you think their master had told them? Yes, that they have a white man in the house, right? And he is going to take care of him till he is better. The old gardener, who was also a house servant, pulled a few hairs on his upper lip. He's quite nervous. He's quite upset at what he's been taught. The master ought not to heal the wound of this white man, he said bluntly to Hannah. The white man ought to die. First he was shot, then the sea caught him and wounded him with her rocks. Right, so he's wounded with the rocks. Yes, so it started bleeding again. If the master heals what the gun did and what the sea did, they will take revenge on us. What did the gun do? Shoot the enemy. What did the sea do? Yeah, so injured the man, right? And they, what is the server saying? That if master tries to change this, they will take revenge on us. Right? So they are there quite superstitious. They have their beliefs. But yes, they are very scared of this situation. I will tell him what you say, Hannah replied courteously, but she herself was also frightened, although she was not superstitious as the old man was. Could it ever be well to help an enemy? Nevertheless, she told Yumi to fetch the hot water and bring it to the room where the white man was. So she was afraid, but she's acting very brave in front of the servants. She's told Yumi, bring hot water to the room. She went ahead and slid back the partitions. Dao was not yet there. Yumi, following, put down her wooden bucket. Then she went over to the white man. When she saw him, her thick lips folded themselves into stubbornness. I have never watched a white man, she said. and I will not wash so dirty a one now. So the Rumi has refused to wash the man. Hana cried at her severely, "You will do what your master commands you." There was so fierce a look of resistance upon Yumi's round dull face that Hana felt unreasonably afraid. Why? The servant was there, you know, not listening to her. And Hana is a little afraid. And what if she reacts in another way? And what if she, you know, goes and complains? After all, if the servant should report something, that was not as it happened. Not as it happened. That they might say that they've given shelter to this person, not telling the truth, that he was wounded. And they brought him in to save his life. "Very well," she said with dignity. "You understand, we only want to bring him to his senses so that we can turn him over as a prisoner. So want him to regain consciousness." Then what do they intend to do? To hand him over to the police. "I will have nothing to do with it," Yumi said. "I am a poor person and it is not my business." Why does she make a reference to a poor person? Why does she say, "I'm a poor person and it is not my business"? So generally, you know, when things happen, who are the ones who suffer? Poor people. What about the rich people? The powerful people? They get away. Isn't it? Right? Not necessarily by giving bribe, but maybe by the connections or whatever way. Yes, even that is there. So she is afraid if something happens, no one is going to listen to them. They might listen to Dr. Sadao because he has a reputation, but nobody is going to listen to us. So do you think her fears are genuine? Yes. So Yumi's fears are there. Okay. "Then please," Hana said gently, "return to your own work." Then she says, "Okay, then go, you do your work." At once, Yumi left the room, but this left Hana with the white man alone. So once again, she's there with the white man. She might have been too afraid to stay had not her anger at Yumi's stubbornness now sustained her. What does this mean? She was afraid, but why is she not showing that she's afraid? Because Yumi is also afraid. So if she is afraid, Yumi will also be afraid. Then what will happen? Dono dar jayenge. Yeah? Both will be afraid. Okay. Yeah, very good. Yumi ke saamne afraid nahi hona chahte. And she was very stubborn, you know, because she wanted Yumi to obey her. She wanted Yumi to obey her. What did she want Yumi to do? To clean the white man, to clean his wounds so that Sadao could operate. But now she has a lot of dignity. She has a lot of self-respect. So she said, if she has said no, I will not ask her again. So who do you think is going to wash the man? "Stupid Yumi," she muttered fiercely. "Is this anything but a man and a wounded, helpless man?" So she is there, you know, trying to console herself. So he's a helpless man. What can he do? Right, he's wounded and almost half dead. In the conviction of her own superiority, how was she superior? How was she superior? She was right. Whom does she consider herself superior to? The white man, the wounded man. Servant, she considers herself superior, that I'm much braver than her, I'm much stronger than her. She doesn't want to. Okay, fine, I'm not going to ask her again. She bent impulsively and untied the knotted rugs that kept the white man covered. What had happened to the man's clothes? They were torn, right? So when she had his breast bare, she dipped the small clean towel that Yumi had brought into the steaming hot water and washed his face carefully. The man's skin, though rough with exposure, was of a fine texture and must have been very blonde when he was a child. So he's not quite an old man, right? From his appearance, he appears to be 25, but he might be younger. Okay, right? And so as she cleans him, she realized that his skin has become rough because of exposure to the sun, to the weather. While she was thinking these thoughts, though not really liking the man better now that he was no longer a child, She kept on washing him until his upper body was quite clean, but she dared not turn him over. Where was Sudhav? So she's just cleaning him and waiting for Sudhav to come. Now her anger was ebbing. Ebbing means, was it rising or was it lowering? Ebb. Come hora. Now she was not there. So her anger was getting less. And she was anxious again, but she was anxious, right? And she rose, wiping her hands on the wrong towel. So she's quite worried and all. Then lest the man be chilled, she put the quilt over him. So she's washed the man and she's taken off his torn clothes. And so she's put the quilt on him. Sudhav, she called softly. He had been about to come in when she called. His hand had been on the door and now he opened it. She saw that he had brought his surgeon's emergency bag and that he wore his surgeon's coat. So, of course, the surgeons, they scrub themselves and they wear their clothes, you know, before the operation. Isn't it right? So he's going to do that surgery. You have decided to operate, she cried. Yes, he said shortly. He turned his back to her and unfolded a sterilized towel upon the floor of the tokonoma. Right? So tokonoma might be a shelf or a mantelpiece over there. So he's put his instruments over there and put his instruments out upon it. Fetch towels, he said. She went obediently, but how anxious now to the linen shelves and took out the towels. They ought also to be old pieces of matting so that the blood would not ruin the fine floor covering. So she wanted to protect her floor also. She went out to the back veranda where the gardener kept strips of matting with which to protect delicate shrubs on cold nights and took an armful of them. Matting, like the, you know, this kind of a cover which you put over the plants when it's extremely cold so that the plants also do not get what? Destroyed or damaged, or they don't get spoiled because of the weather. But when she went back into the room, she saw this was useless. Why? What had happened? The blood had already soaked through the packing in the man's wound and had ruined the mat under him. So already bleeding a lot. Oh, the mat, she cried. Yes, it is ruined, Sudhav replied, as though he did not care. Help me to turn him, he commanded her. She obeyed him without a word and he began to wash the man's back carefully. Where was the wound? At the back, yes, in the man's back. Did you, Yumi would not wash him, she said. So she's complaining to Sudhav. Who's Yumi? The servant. Did you wash him then? Sudhav asked, not stopping for a moment, his swift, concise movements. Do you think Sudhav is actually listening to her? Or he's busy there? Swift, concise movements. What is he doing? He's busy there, you know, cleaning and looking for the bullet, right? Okay. So he's not there listening much to her complaints. Yes, she said, he did not seem to hear her, but she was used to his absorption when he was at work. She wondered for a moment if it mattered to him what was the body upon which he worked so long as it was for the work he did so excellently. And this is what a true doctor should be like. A true surgeon should not worry about whom, you know, like about the country, the religion, right, the color of the skin, but should operate irrespective of all these things. And the Sudhav was like that. So he's one of the finest surgeons. You will have to give the anesthetic if he needs it, he said. What does an anesthetic do? What does an anesthetic do? Anesthetic, yeah. Yeah, so it dulls the pain. You don't feel the pain, isn't it right? So he would need the anesthetic. You think this man would need the anesthetic? He's already unconscious. He's not aware, but still, just to be on the safer side. I, she repeated blankly, but never have I. Do you think Hannah has done any operation before? No. It is easy enough, he said impatiently. He was taking out the packing now. Which packing? What had Sudhav put in the man's wound? Moss. So he's taking it out, yes, and the blood began to flow more quickly. He peered into the wound with the bright surgeon's light fastened on his forehead. So Like, see here in the picture, you can see that he has that light and he puts that band or with the light on it, and so that he can see the wound clearly, right? He peered into the wound with a bright surgeon's light fastened on his head. The bullet is still there, he said with cool interest. Now I wonder how deep this rock wound is. If it is not too deep, it may be that I can get the bullet. But the bleeding is not superficial. He has lost much blood. So he is now, what is he now going to do? He's going to remove the bullet. At this moment, Hannah choked. He looked up and saw her face the color of sulfur. What is the color of sulfur? What's the color of sulfur? Sulfur is gray.
Yellow.
I think so. Maybe one of the early experiments, you know, which you do, you have your sulfur and iron fillings, or fir magnets se separate karte. This is something that we had done, and I like to teach about, you know, ferrous and non-ferrous things. So sulfur is there, pale yellow. Why Anna is pale yellow? Why the color? What has happened to Anna?
She was afraid,
right? Seeing so much of blood, and she is maybe seeing this surgery for the first time. So she is not very strong. Don't faint, he said sharply. He did not put down his exploring instrument. What is his instrument exploring? Ankit is talking too much. That is why he gets 20 in English. Because he doesn't listen. Exploring instrument. What is Sir Siddhau exploring? The wound. He is looking for the bullet. Yes, very good. Don't faint, he said sharply. He did not put down his exploring instrument. If I stop now, the man will surely die. So he is in another dilemma. Should I take care of my wife or should I take care of the patient? And he says, never mind, nothing is going to happen to her. Let me take care of the patient, right? He should not die. She clapped her hands to her mouth and leaped up and ran out of the room. So she is getting very, what, sick. Outside in the garden, he heard her retching. Retching means vomiting at the sight of blood. But he went on with his work. So Siddhau is so dedicated. Do you think it's common? Many of us cannot stand the sight of blood. You know, like we pretend to be very strong, but when we see someone lying wounded and injured, and of course, we just cannot control ourselves. There are many of us, right? And so even it happens with the budding doctors also. And it is with the passage of time, they become strong. They become accustomed to the sight of blood. Okay, so poor Hannah, she is unable to control herself. Okay?
Yeah.
Yes.